Welcome to NTN Nightly. I am Janelle Nouvelle. This edition's top stories. St. Lucia, as Chair of CARIFORUM, hosts the 25th meeting of Council of Ministers amid critical global issues. The Department of Physical Planning builds capacity in spatial data. Government's plans for an overhaul of the national road network continue to advance. All that plus the latest in youth development, sports, and the NTN Nouvelle, Kweyol. A number of global developments requiring the urgent attention of the Caribbean Forum of African, Caribbean and Pacific States, CARIFORUM, are being discussed here. Among the critical issues are Brexit and implementation of the CARIFORUM European Union Economic Partnership Agreement. As Chair of the CARIFORUM, St. Lucia is hosting the 25th meeting of the Council of Ministers.
Chair of CARIFORUM and Minister for Commerce, Industry, Investment, Enterprise Development and Consumer Affairs, Bradley Felix, described the meeting as a timely one as there are many important issues facing the region which require urgent action. According to Felix, it is imperative that action is taken to safeguard the region's access to the UK market.
It is now up to us, politicians, to sign this agreement now, or make arrangements to sign as soon as possible so that whatever happens in the United Kingdom or between the United Kingdom and Europe, our trade is protected and the livelihoods of our people are guaranteed. The UK is our largest trading partner in the European Union, and we must therefore ensure that we take action to safeguard our continued preferential access to that market, to ensure that our exporters and our traders can continue to do business in the UK market.
Britain's decision to leave the European Union, as well as the ongoing negotiations for a successor to the Cotonou Convention, are also among issues to be discussed. The chair indicated that the CARIFORUM must approach negotiations with the region's priorities on the forefront.
We must approach these negotiations from two perspectives. One, how we participate in these negotiations as part of the ACP, and two, how we promote and protect our strategic interests and priorities in a regional arrangement between ourselves and the EU. The negotiations for the ACP-EU post-Cotonou agreement is taking place in a changed and challenging environment. Therefore, this meeting provides the opportunity to discuss among ourselves our priorities and give political instructions to our technicians on the basis of which they themselves can effectively and strategically engage their counterparts in the EU as part of these negotiations.
The two-day 25th meeting of the Council of Ministers of CARIFORUM was convened on Thursday.
The Department of Physical Planning recently benefited from free training workshops aimed at strengthening its capacity to design and implement infrastructural works that can better withstand natural disasters. The training forms part of the Disaster Vulnerability Reduction Project. Lisa Joseph has more.
The main focus of the Disaster Vulnerability Reduction Project, DVRP, is to create safer and more resilient communities for the people of St. Lucia. The core concept of building smarter includes energy efficiency, cost savings, and ultimately resilience to natural and climate-related disasters. Deputy Permanent Secretary in the Physical Planning Department, Hildreth Lewis, notes that capacity building exercises, like the just concluded spatial data sessions, will result in improved efficiency in carrying out tasks by staff.
Under the DVRP, were able to get funds to legalize our use of design software, primarily the Autodesk software packages. And with that regularization of our use came access to a number of different software packages that greatly enhance our capabilities of design.
Lead trainer Mike Gaitis is confident that staff who benefited from the building information modeling technology training will now be able to take raw data and turn it into valuable, actionable information, which can help develop value during every stage of the construction process, ultimately saving the country lots of money.
And if you can construct it, the project, digitally, and improve it, then you go ahead and do it, do the real project. So you have the problems that you're facing, you can fix them digitally, and once you take it to the real project, everything will move smoothly and without problems. That's basically the idea. I mean, we're talking about saving in maybe between 10 and 30% in time and materials. The results that the industry is getting with this new flow of work is really amazing. Governments like United Kingdom, United States, some other countries in Europe, Australia, now in Latin America, Chile, Brazil, Colombia, Panama, Peru, they're moving forward with this as a standard of the industry. And that's where we want to take the government we help the government of solution to go.
Some 20 persons comprising architects, architectural assistants, engineers, land and quantity surveyors from the Department of Physical Planning received training over a three-week period. From the Government Information Service, Lisa Joseph reporting.
The Department of Health and Wellness is taking a closer look at the impact of oral health on non-communicable diseases. This as the department's spearhead activities commemorating World Oral Day, observed annually on March 20. Here's Anicia Antoine.
Oral diseases are known to have adverse effects on individuals with non-communicable diseases, such as diabetes, resulting in the need for immediate action to be taken on a community level. To this end, the Dental Services Unit of the Department of Health and Wellness has joined the world in commemorating World Oral Health Day. Dr. Sherry Ephraim Lecomte, Senior Dental Surgeon of the Department of Health and Wellness, urged individuals to make a concerted effort to brush, floss, rinse, and eat healthy foods every day.
Good oral health is known to be one of the main pillars of general health and well-being, as stated by the World Dental Federation. The risk factors for NCDs and oral health diseases, such as sugar, tobacco, and alcohol, are cross-cutting, and so incorporating oral health perspectives into the National NCD Plan will help to strengthen the department's drive in reducing the burden of diabetes, hypertension, and heart disease.
Dr. Lecomte encouraged diabetics to pay special attention to their oral health, as the lack of good oral hygiene can lead to a volume of bacteria and plaque in the mouth.
The bacteria can enter into the bloodstream, increasing the toxins in the body that ultimately affects the ability of the body to manage the sugar and insulin levels, thereby causing the diabetes to become uncontrolled. The American Dental Association and some studies have also found that patients with poorly controlled glucose levels are more likely to develop gum disease than those whose glucose levels are controlled.
Various clinics around the island conducted an open day for patients where they provided education and shared information on the connection between oral health and overall health. The Department of Health and Wellness also organized an open day for staff, patients, and visitors.
Campaigns of the past 9 years that were conducted by the Dental Services Unit have partly been based on the fact that good oral health starts early, spearheading treatment interventions for students from preschoolers to adolescents, as well as the implementation of innovative oral health promotion activities such as the well-supported poetry, poster, and spelling bee competitions.
World Oral Health Day 2019 is being celebrated under the theme Say Ah, Act on Mouth Health. From the Government Information Service, I am Anicia Antoine reporting.
This is NTN Nightly. Coming up, the latest happenings in youth development and sports with Ryan O'Brien.
With just one click, the internet connects people, businesses, and nations. Being connected can open a world of information and opportunities. You can get services and products of your choice much faster, from electronic financial transactions to connecting with family and friends, from being up to date with the latest news and information to learning new skills and acquiring academic qualifications, all from the convenience of your home or wherever you roam. Get connected today.
This message is brought to you as a public service announcement by Ectel, the NTRC, and this station.
Welcome back. We join Ryan O'Brien for the latest happenings in youth development and sports.
Hello once again to your update from the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports. I'm Ryan O'Brien. The finals of the 2019 Mass United Insurance Schools Cricket Tournament will be contested between St. Mary's College and Miku Secondary, as both teams registered victories in the semi-finals of the competition played Wednesday. At the Gozile Playing Field, St. Mary's College defeated last year's joint champion Sir Arthur Lewis Community College in a low-scoring match by 16 runs. St. Mary's College, batting first after winning the toss, dismissed for 144 in 27.1 overs. With the tournament's leading run scorer, West Indies under 15 player and team captain, Akim Ogis, top scoring at 51, which included 7 fours and 1 six. Other useful scores for St. Mary's College came from Shaquane Prudent with 24, Desni Gidhari 17, and Zidane Arthur 15. The main wicket takers for Sir Arthur Lewis Community College were Craig Elise with 3 for 15, Simeon Gerson 3 for 30, Kyle Adonis 2 for 25. In reply, Sir Arthur Lewis Community College bowled out for 128 in 40.2 overs with Chaz Sipal and Simeon Gerson top scoring of 27 each and Rashad Gaston making 13. Bowling for St. Mary's College, Amari Venner bagged 4 for 20, Shaquane Prudent 3 for 20, and Akim Ogis 2 for 32. At the Wen Playing Field in Monipo, Miku Secondary enjoyed a comfortable 43-run victory over Corin Secondary in another low-scoring game. Miku Secondary batting first after being inserted by Corin Secondary, dismissed for 114 in 30 overs, with Brent Edward making 23, Jilan Justin 11, and Desherge Henry 10. The chief wicket takers for Corin Secondary were Captain Lee Solomon with 4 for 10, Nave Hubert 2 for 16, Darry Green 2 for 31. In reply, Corin Secondary bowled out for 71 in 23.4 overs, with Daniel Edwin making 15, the only batsman to reach double figures. Doing the damage with the ball for Miku Secondary were Neandy Turville 3 for 10, Marklin Estefan 3 for 19, and Desherge Henry 3 for 22. The finals will be played on a date to be announced. The Everest Masters cricket team from Guyana arrived here today for a one-week tour of St. Lucia. The club, which was founded in 1914, has produced illustrious players like Joe Solomon, Rohan Kanai, Derek Kalicharan, while in recent times have produced the likes of Shibnarine Chanderpaul, Chanderpaul Hemraj, Tijanarine Chanderpaul, among others. While here, the Guyanese team will play 3 matches against local opposition, including a Prime Minister's 11. The team's first match will be against a Northern Masters team on Friday from 1 in the afternoon at the Mindafili Park. The second match will also be at the Mindafili Park on Saturday, starting at 1 o'clock against the Castries Masters 11. The final match will be against the Prime Minister's 11 on Sunday from 1 p.m. at the Darren Sammy Cricket Ground. With April's Youth Month fast approaching, it's probably a good time to remind you that the deadline for nominations for Youth Awards is Friday, March 29. Nominees must be citizens of St. Lucia between the ages of 15 and 35. Self-nominations not allowed. The achievements or noteworthy service should be between the specific time period of 12 months. In this case, January 1st to December 31st, 2018. Only completed nomination forms received by the deadline will be considered. And with that, we come to the end of our update from the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports. I'm Ryan O'Brien.
Thanks, Ryan. Government's plans for an overhaul of the national road network continue to advance with discussions on the expansion of alternative routes into the capital city. Prime Minister the Honorable Alan Shasney and Minister for Infrastructure Honorable Stevenson King recently met with Kuwaiti Ambassador Mohammed Fidel Khalif to discuss road upgrades in the north of the island.
Let us look at the back roads and see how we can improve the back roads to the standard of probably the Castries-Grozny Highway that can be more attractive, motorable, and more efficient to allow people to get to their destinations if they are not going to go, if they are not bound for Castries. So in other words, as it is now, because the Castries-Grozny Highway is the more ideal road network or the ideal motorway, people tend to use that road, but you must enter Castries, creating a bottleneck. In certain locations, for example, from the Union Junction up towards Moshi, up towards Grivier, to straighten up some of those hairpin bends and turns there to have it a little better. We are saying we need to go in and do a comprehensive overhaul and reconstruction of the back roads and make it more efficient, more attractive, so that you have greater efficiency on the roads. Now we have a new proposal which would allow us to achieve the four lanes that the former administration was speaking about and to go for an alternative route that will provide for a northbound highway and a southbound highway without interference.
The project will be financed through the OPEC Fund for International Development and the Kuwait Fund for Arab Economic Development. Stay with NTN Nightly. Up next, Primus Hutchinson is here with the NTN Nouvelle, a Kweyol.
Hypertension is a deadly disease that is common in St. Lucia. We depend on blood pressure monitors to determine if our blood pressure is too high or too low. Should a reading on these measuring devices be incorrect, we are literally putting our lives at risk. Doctors, caregivers, and patients, get your blood pressure meters verified by the St. Lucia Bureau of Standards to ensure the accuracy of measuring devices. Look for a green pass sticker on the blood pressure meter at your next visit to the doctor. The correct reading can mean the difference between life and death.
For more information, contact the St. Lucia Bureau of Standards at 456-0546 or email slbs@candw.lc or visit the website at www.slbs.org.lc. St. Lucia Bureau of Standards, making quality and standards our way of life.
Welcome back. We join Primus Hutchinson for the NTN Nouvelle, Kweyol.
Monsieur le Général, Monsieur Madame, Département qui est responsable pour information. Gouvernement CTLC, ça c'est GIS, Assemblée Pays Télévision Nationale, pays NTN, Capacito, Nouvelle Kweyol, présentant Primus Hutchinson. Ministre qui est responsable pour sécurité nationale et justice, sénateur honorable Hamangel Francis, déclaré que le gouvernement a cette liste toujours ni l'intérêt les travailleurs en secteur public PIA et aussi les agences. Selon le ministre Francis, toute évidence là pour les gens qui savent à ces provisions que j'ai faites pour assister service les pompiers et le département de services de fait et ambulance PIA. Sénateur Francis a annoncé que gouvernement récemment employé 80 officiers pompiers et aussi rehaussé position 50 lots. À part de ça, M. Francis dit que plusieurs officiers trouvaient étonnement spécial à leur pays et aussi à cette liste. Même, il remarque que c'est la première fois que ces pompiers ont trouvé des grands assistants. Francis aussi annoncé que le gouvernement a déjà rangé toutes ces stations et établi facilité pour protéger les pompiers. Selon le sénateur Francis, le gouvernement a présentement considéré haute représentatif les pompiers, ils ont appel pour tirer en bas spéciale protection et placer les hôpitaux à bas service des obligements. Ils ont aussi demandé pour un commissionnaire neuf, mais le cabinet n'a pas été d'accord. Francis dit que le sénateur Francis a fait ses pompiers à comprendre si ils ont trouvé placé en bas service des obligements. Je passe à continuer au pouvoir comme un service de spéciale protection. Alors, c'est une situation qui est bien sensible. Comme la Terre qui a observé la journée internationale pour de l'eau, le ministre de l'Agriculture a fait un appel pour que cette liste apprécie l'importance de l'eau en complémentaire. On est avec Ezekiel Joseph, qui a pris un temps en titre pour causer et puis nous concerner l'importance de l'eau pas seulement pour jeunesse là, mais valeur de l'eau pour monde en cette ici exécutité monde qui ni briser service avec bonne qualité d'eau avec bon service de l'eau à cette ici.
La nation chaque côté cette ici qu'on va parler actuellement dat nous ka fait ou fait chaque effort pour manière nous ça bail c'est monde ça glo à son ça OK consistent basis plus reliable et puis bon quality glo et puis ouais nous ka fait ça throughout l'année but it's also important pour nous apprendre un jour en l'année pour nous ça aller parler about glo parler qui ça les challenges là nous ni qui ça nous ka fait corps gouvernement qui ça nous ka fait corps peuple pour qui manière nous ça at least by moon glo plus à son consistent basis.
Sans fouer ou pas ça, vivre l'amour à la manière qui m'est. Parce que vous vous fouer pour faire un chai bagay. Mais nous avons aussi reconnaissé journée Glo International, li demain, ça c'est 22 mars. So nous avons une relation fouer avec Glo, avec importance relation. Sans fouer ou pas ça, ça n'est Glo. Pour l'année, parce que pour l'année, il y a un chébé gloire pour un chaitan et qu'il y a un jeu en la vie petit à petit. So, c'est pour ça que la vie toujours dans un chai gloire. Mais nous avons, en tout travail d'éducation, nous avons fait à ce département là pour oui. Nous tout est concerné dans le nous avons still le monde qui a juste coupé végétation, qui a brûlé, qui a coupé fourré.
Si le prospect, il pas ni un problème pour moun couper bois en les forêts mais ça ni pour fait et puis en pile considération
so ou pas vle détruire et là regarder quoi actuellement ou ka wè c'est dommage leur affaire ka impacter en les qualité glo nous regarder en vie wè en tant qu'actuellement moun ça aller en la vie bien ay la vie ay fait nécessaire. Mais en chai, c'est là où vient nous, en cette liste, ou pas ça, ouais, ça fait, parce que là où vient les ordi, il y a un chai plastique. Et qu'un chai bagay qui s'y pas si posé là, nous avons là. So, ça s'y posé d'où, là. Nous-mêmes, quand contaminer même gloire, poisonner même gloire, nous, riches nous, bousins, et que nous avons contaminé. Bon là regarde temps qu'on actuellement nous en saison soleil là ça c'est là on pas ca angel la pluie fouya style qu'a fait travail pour la gloire en dit dans l'environnement bon nous mais nous style pas ça aller dans chai c'est là ouvia c'est tout because nous même prisonnier
en le monde qu'a quoi qui service de l'eau c'est une qui tout peuple ni doit recevoir sans ne sauve mais il qu'a prend un pile travail pour continuer pour tirer service l'eau sorti en la rivière et traiter pour peuple la servir. Ça c'est l'opinion directeur exécutif pour Institut qui est responsable pour guider les autorités de l'eau à Caribla, M. Ignace Jean. Selon Jean, ça c'est pas un service pour Kakwe qui avait la vaille. Il fait un appel pour Asko faire un meilleur effort pour indiquer peuple là concerner des postes et qu'à point pour ménager de l'eau en pays.
Parce que mon cas dit eh ben puits de l'eau ça c'est un autre bail qui va concerner tout le monde au lieu de la terre parce que tout le monde qui percevre depuis de l'eau qui vient dans la vie eh ben si vous tirez en bas terre ça c'est de l'eau bondée vous pas pour payer pour lui mais bagaille là c'est ça il y a chaque dépense par exemple en Saint-Lucie les wasco ni pour pomper de l'eau sorti dame là en roseau John Compton dame là pour vivre 6 ans pour traiter il ca coûter Wasco en haut 200 000 dollars par mois pour payer il courant pour pomper de l'eau ça là ça c'est en pile dépense
la terre a observé journée internationale pour de l'eau vendredi le 22 mars monsieur madame c'est comme ça nous avons trois nouvelles là pour aujourd'hui moi remercie autant pour garder moi ca ba une invitation pour j'ai puis moi encore si de conserver la vie les gars présenter l'autre nouvelle à Kweyol à présent nous ca vie pour Chanel.
Merci, Appeal Primus. Here's a look at what's happening to us weather-wise.
Skies are generally fair, becoming cloudy at times with a few scattered showers. The Atlantic high-pressure system will maintain a moderate easterly wind flow across the eastern Caribbean region over the next few days. Low-level clouds drifting with this flow will bring a few showers over the islands during the next 24 hours. The tide for Castries Harbour was high at 4:24 p.m. and will be low again at 10:07 p.m. The tide for VFR Bay was high at 5:31 p.m. and will be low again at 11:34 p.m. The sea is slight to moderate with waves 3 to 5 feet or 0.9 to 1.5 meters. The sun will rise Friday at 6:06 a.m.
That brings us to the end of NTN Nightly. Join us next time at 7 p.m. with a repeat at 7 a.m. You can also catch up with us anytime on the St. Lucia Government Facebook page or YouTube channel. I am Janelle Norville.